China has the largest video surveillance network in the world and plans to expand it to more than 600 million cameras over the next 2 years. With the rise in facial recognition and artificial intelligence, it feels more like someone is watching all those cameras at all times.
Hi, I'm Ellie. I'm in China, and I just got busted for jaywalking with facial recognition technology.
Stations like this one are part of a new plan by the Chinese government to publicly shame citizens caught breaking the law.
If you cross the street against the light, cameras with facial recognition technology will take a picture of your face, cross-reference it with your government ID, and then post it up there to embarrass you.
But China isn't embracing facial recognition just to catch jaywalkers. The technology is starting to appear just about anywhere you can imagine. It helps make menu recommendations at your local fast food spot. You can also pay for your food with your face.
Doesn't matter whether you smile or not, even though it's called smile to pay. Even if you are wearing a wig or have a heavy makeup, it will still recognize you.
It even curbs waste of toilet paper at public bathrooms. My gift. This is all I get for the next 9 minutes. And then I come back again, I try to get more. Chinese tech companies are now at the cutting edge of developing new and sophisticated ways to do video analysis.
Right now we're going into SenseTime, one of the biggest companies involved in developing that technology. Oh, that's me.
这个是我们的人脸识别的门禁，那它可以自动的识别人脸，然后方便员工进出。你站在门口，它很快就会把门打开。对于外来的人员来讲呢，他站在门口，门并不会打开。So
you know when someone's late?
所以这个呢，是我们的一个肢体检测、肢体识别的一个功能。这个是我们的一个会场迎宾签到的一个系统，那它可以作为你的牌，并不需要说每次进出都需要刷卡，我们可以替代这么一个方式。这个是我们给线下做这种广告营销互动的一个平台，它可以很快的识别出你的魅力值，然后性表情、戴了墨镜、欢乐值、年龄以及你的性别。那相应的，它会有一个这个颜值的一个排行榜，都可以在一个后台得到。Yeah, now you are the number one.
But despite all the goofy applications SenseTime is developing has serious real-world implications.
这边是我们给智慧城市平安城市打造的一整套的系统，然后呢，这里头细节的我们可以看到很多标签，包括人的着装、上身和下身的着装，然后颜色、性别、年龄，然后对于车辆我们可以识别到3000多种的车型，这个包括到具体品牌。那这样一个产品，它叫视频结构化，它能够很好的把视频中的一些关键信息提取出来，比如说我今天要找中午11点钟经过这个路口的红色车辆。 然后可以很快的把这样一些目标物给检索出来。这个是我们给这是上海外滩的一个场景，我们是给上海外滩的这个摄像头去做了一个人群的布控。左上这张图是一个原始的图片，然后同样的我们可以得到左下这张图是一个人群驻留时间的一个估计。那红色部分表示这些人群在这驻留时间非常长了。So
it can track suspicious activity within a large crowd.
它更多的是能够及时的发现一些异常状况，能够做更实时的响应，来减少损失。
Are you ever bothered by having no anonymity because there are cameras watching all the time?
从我自己的体验来讲，其实对这样的一些事情并不会很担忧。但是呢，像这样的一些算法或者说技术应用到实战的场景中去以后呢，如果说你真的要做坏事，以后就要小心了。But
the reach of this technology goes way beyond public areas and increasingly infiltrates private spaces as well.
We're going into a government housing complex. Instead of doormen, they have security cameras with facial recognition technology. And we're going to go see how it works.
还是一个门禁和一个摄像头关联。 这个咱们现在看到这个画面呢，是我们的一个，我这里边也可以看到保障人员的每个日期的保障人员的出入情况，非保障人员的和陌生人的一个出入情况。
This is the number of visitors, and this is all of the residents. And this is our most popular person with 142.
然后呢，我们每个月月底的时候会出一个月报，提供给房管局，就是监管部门。因为这是他连续跑了，现在这个项目跑了快一年了，然后可能他累积的比较多。
How much more is your system doing that you're not allowed to show us?
然后工作挺多的，然后我在这边的话，不太方便透露太多。
In China, there are few protections limiting how much information the government can collect about its 1.4 billion citizens. Everyone over the age of 16 is required to have an official state-issued ID card that the government now wants to use to centralize all that information. And China is investing heavily in tech companies to help transform that government data into a virtually omniscient surveillance network. One of those companies is Megvii.It recently received a capital investment of nearly $500 million, part of which is from a state-run VC fund. But the name chosen for its premier piece of technology is a bit of a tell.
Skynet. Yeah. What is that?
The Terminator is the favorite film of our founder. So they use the same name, but they want to put something good into this system.
So, okay, in the Terminator, Skynet is evil, rains down death from the sky. But in China, Skynet is good.
Yeah, that's the difference.
So how do you think your facial recognition technology will change China?
Everything happened in the public can be recorded. We can know exactly what happened in every second, in every corner of the city. This is a video stream in a subway station by our smart camera.So we can capture every face in real time. See, like some criminal person is out there. There is the red box. So there is a warning to the police station that there is a criminal person. So I need to locate them.
So when it looks out onto a crowd, it's tracking all these faces and it's cross-checking those faces against what?
Criminal database.
And how many fugitives have been apprehended through this system?
Over 3,000 cases in nationwide. Wow. Yeah.Just one year.
In 1 year?
Yeah, 1 year.
Wow. So what you're working on now already seems like sci-fi. What do you think the future will look like in like 5 years?
Have you seen a film just like Black Mirror? You just stand there and your face there is a point. So maybe that is the future.
But that's like a horror show.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think that is maybe the kind of the future. Every people have their social points, I think.
If you like spit gum on the sidewalk, it would
record. Yeah, your points maybe.
And your point would go down?
maybe that in the future.
But that future isn't too far away.
Now China's government is testing a new social credit score system which would rank its citizens based on their online behavior.
While it won't fully roll out until 2020, starting this year, China will ban people with a bad score from booking flights and train rides.We spoke with a lawyer who represents clients considered to be untrustworthy by the communist government about what this could mean for the future of China.
What are the risks of this kind of program?
国家呢现在在搞大数据，在通过各种渠道呢收集公民的这个信息，目前已经达到了很先进的地步。无论是道德的或者呢这个诚信道德方面的，还是呢法律制裁方面的力量都不够。而我的感觉是呢，你技术的先进啊，控制手段的这个先进啊，有没有用到，就是说你这个公平的啊
？What do you think of the government's argument that a social credit system will create a more meritocratic society？
这个本来呢是对的啊，就是好人有好报，是吧？你一贯遵纪守法的话，但实际上呢，由于这个前面我们讲的这个两个前提的。就是道德环境和那个法治环境的那个，如果这两个环境不健全，这个信用体系也会变味，会走歪了，甚至会把一个善良的这个愿望呢产生了恶的结果。
But China isn't the only place experimenting with facial recognition applications. An airport in the Middle East is already planning face scanning aquariums as security checkpoints. In Europe, state-sanctioned and private initiatives are testing this technology in multiple locations, from train stations to online classes. And in the U.S., private companies are investing millions to secure government contracts, which could make machine learning and image recognition a regular part of police work. Law professor Andrew Guthrie Ferguson is a leading expert on big data policing. He spoke to us about the ramifications that these technologies could present. When you look at China's system of facial recognition and video surveillance, what do you see?
I see the future, and it scares me. If you have the capability to identify people and patterns, and you can chill association about where you go and why you're going there, it really will change the relationship between citizens and their governments.
In China, the government has heavily invested in these companies developing facial recognition technology. In the U.S., it's still more in the private sector. Can you explain the difference?
So much of the story of big data policing has been small startup companies, or even sometimes the big tech companies, that are pushing police to use new technologies. One of the open questions is, who owns this data? Take police body cams, right? Right now, there is sort of an arms race of people trying to sell police body cameras to policing all across America. All of that data from all of those officers is actually really valuable for other non-law enforcement purposes. You're really capturing patterns of society. And if the private companies can use that data for other things, even sell it for other reasons, they're gonna wanna profit it. Part of the reason why we have seen this move toward big data policing is because it sounds like an objective move to sort of turn the page from some of the racial tension we've seen after Ferguson and after Baltimore and after Staten Island to something that sounds more objective. Don't worry, this is data-driven. The problem is the data comes from us. And if you're not cautious about how you're collecting that information and then using it, you're just gonna reify the same biases.
So how slippery is the slope we're standing on? How quickly could this be implemented here?
The technology you see in China exists. It's working, and it can do the same thing here. Right now, our sort of regulatory legislative action just isn't there. We don't have protections to say it couldn't happen. Young people growing up in America today are pretty used to being surveilled by their phones and their Facebooks and their Snapchats and the rest. We might have different constitutional protections, but it's still unsettled. And it's an open question about how we react. And I hope we start asking those questions to react now.